Hello, today we are going to make an assessment again of John Donne, but today's topic would be to assess his particular style, that was metaphysics, and therefore the title today is Metaphysical Poetry of John Donne. John Donne belonged to the Elizabethan age and assumed him upon himself the task of dealing with the subject of love, as was prevalent and as was very popular with the writers of Elizabethan age. But this topic, love, was dealt with in a very singular manner, and for which let us try to understand why the succeeding writers conferred upon him and his style, the writing, the word metaphysical. The term metaphysical poets was coined by the critic Samuel Johnson to describe a loose group of 17th century English poets whose work was characterized by the inventive use of conceits. Now, what is a conceit? We all know that to make the work implicit, to make the thought clear, people make use of comparisons. And when the comparison is direct, we think it, we term it simile. When it is indirect, we call it a metaphor. But when the comparison is extraordinary and goes beyond the ordinary understanding, then we call it conceit. Conceit is yoking perforce two very disparate ideas. And the metaphysical term was again associated with his writings due to a greater emphasis on the spoken rather than the lyrical quality of the verse. In John Donne, we realize that he does not care to make his poems lyrical. Of course, they are lyrical, but the emphasis is on the speech, because his poems are argumentative speeches. He captures his audience. He captures the attention of his audience with the very extraordinary point of view that he has to suggest about love, physical, spiritual, and love for God. Now, what are the characteristics of Donne's style? As a metaphysical poet, he takes into consideration, it's not taking into consideration, he employs very specific features. The first and foremost among them is abrupt openings. When he has to begin a poem, he just catches you in the moment of it. And then when he has to speak about canonization, he says, "For God's sake, hold your tongue and let me love." It is as if he is reacting to an omniscient audience and he is stopping them from interrupting with the love that he is involved in. The second feature of his writings is paradoxes. He employs paradoxes because the point of view that he is presenting in his poems about love is so particular, is so specific, that paradox is the only figure of speech that would most suitably fit in. And again in canonization, when he says that we are the phoenix riddle hath more wit, and he says we too being one are it. There is involvement of irony. treatment of as is implicit in the treatment of death in the poem Death in the sonnet Death Be Not Proud. It is ironical that he is not afraid. He dares death and challenges him by saying that death is not in any way fearful to him. He says that she is a companion of war, sufferings, and then it consumes away only very weak people. It cannot come and consume a person away. This is an ironical citation that he employs in his poems. And above all, one of the most specific features of his writings is dislocations. Dislocation is a particular device by which a poet achieves double purpose of making his poems complex and also of shifting focus from the first word to the word at the end. As described, dislocation is a breach in the word order to clarify, emphasize, or focus on particular concepts over others. As in the expression, from Death Be Not Proud, he says, for who those whom thou thinkest thou thus overthrow. So the focus here is on overthrowing power of death, which overthrows only weak people. This should have been otherwise. You overthrow only whom you think are overthrown. Another feature of his writings is his individualism. No one would have thought a very insignificant character, very insignificant organism as a flea to become a marriage temple, and killing of the flea would be like a sacrilege. This particularly is John Donne's style. Another feature which causes him to be called as a metaphysical writer is his quest for learning. John Donne does not limit himself with language just. He delves into other subjects, other principles, other streams of learnings. Like, he cites from maths the two lovers being the two legs of a compass. In Valediction Forbidding Morning, he takes the learning from geography when he says that there are maps come over maps and territories are occupied by people. So in the same way, when his image is cast upon the eyes of his beloved, it is like making of a map, possession of the body, possession of the personage by the reflection of the person that falls into the eye. So this is a very specific feature which goes on to make him a rightful poet to be given the term metaphysical. In his writings, we find yet another feature, that is wordplay. He plays upon the words. It is like juggling with one image with the other image and juxtaposing them together for very ulterior ends. When he has argued the physical involvement in the flea, and when the flea has been killed due to the provocation of the lover to his beloved, that now the marriage has been solemnized, and yet there has been no pain, there has been no suffering, nor yet any symptom of guilt, of shame. So then, in the concluding lines, he does the word play and says, only just so much honor when thou yieldest to me will waste, as this flea's death took life from thee. He also employs wit and the separation of the body, the separation from the soul, of the soul from the body, is done with a very symptomatic image of the virtuous men passing mildly away and asking their souls to go, while the friends are confused whether the breath is going or whether the breath has fled away. This is a beautiful example of wit, and you can find several such examples in his writings. Now we come to the best part, the very singular quality of his writings, that is use of conceits. As defined very simply, conceits are extraordinary comparison between two disparate things, and which comparison yokes together by violence the two images. Let us look into a few examples. When he writes the poem Flea, he compares the flea, the very ignominious organism, and exalts him to the position of a temple, a marriage bed, and confirms that killing this flea would be like three sins: murder, suicide, and sacrilege. So when the flea is compared to a temple and marriage bed, we are overwhelmed. No one would have thought that this creature would become a temple. A second example is from the poem Valediction Forbidding Mourning, where the two lovers are compared with two legs of a compass. How the lovers, who are sublime beings, are reduced to the physical entity of a compass. This is his. With this, however, he achieves the beautiful purpose of highlighting the lovers to that solemn image in which the fixed foot brings back the roaming foot, and it is the fixity of the fixed foot that makes the circle just and causes the union back to the place where he had begun. That is, anchoring the idea that great love would cause a union with God. Then in the poem, The Relic, he compares the grave with a meeting place that will cause no separation. He says, the world might not let us love, so let us meet in the grave. Because when one is united with the other in a grave, there can be no separation. Then in the poem, Go and Catch a Falling Star, he compares a woman, a true and fair woman, with a pilgrimage. How divine! In the age when women were not thought to be constant and fair, because Shakespeare had written, Frailty, thy name is woman. He says that a woman that is true and fair is as elevating, is as gratifying to a soul as a pilgrimage's. Then in the poem Canonization, he says that since the two lovers do not know sex, that there is no involvement of sex in the love that they are expressing for each other, he says, he compares them to the phoenix, because in a phoenix body, in a single body, exist the male and the female, and therefore there can be no sex. Then again, in Valediction Forbidding Mourning, he says that the eyes are the place where the images of each other are falling, because they are facing each other, and the image of one falls on the other's eyes, then half part, only the front side of the face is, only the front side of the face of the person is visible and not the back. So it is a hemisphere. But this hemisphere has no declining west and has no sharp north. Summing up, John Donne achieves a very high position among writers of all times due to his intellectual fervor. His poetry is not for assimilation by ordinary minds. It is intellectual composition for intellectual hearts, intellectual minds. He shakes you from your very naive state of mind and drags you into the world that he has juggled up. He catches you with an abrupt beginning, argues his point of view against normal understanding, gives arguments in support of his point of view. The arguments which are taken, they are justifications from several branches of learning. And you meander through with him only to realize that the conclusion that he is given is really an aspect permanently of love. Of love physical, when he writes down the poem Flea, and we are made to believe that consenting to the wooing is not going to cause harms. But also, as in Valediction Forbidding Mourning, we are convinced that if it is platonic love, we definitely would be meeting and retreating to the place that we have emerged from, the heaven. And it would be entirely the attribute of the beloved, the fixity of the constancy of our love that will reunite us to our Maker. And when it is his religious sonnets, then in the octave we are given an idea, and the conclusion that is given in this estate, we believe, we firmly believe with what John Donne has to say. This is metaphysics, not physical, beyond and above the physical understanding of concepts. And for this, John Donne will stay immortal among all poets to come. He has his special position, and he will continue to enjoy this position, for he can rightly be called as the father of metaphysical poetry. Thank you.